Welcome back. Many of us come from blended families these days, and financial struggles sometimes follow suit.
So joining us today is Alex Manassa from Szarka Financial. We thank you for being here.
Every time
you come, you bring us such great information.
Well,
so we're talking about blended families today.
Yes.
And this is something that probably a lot of people don't even think about, the financial do's and don'ts.
Absolutely. I get a lot of this in my practice. Okay, people, they're together for the second time, meaning they've been married before,
sure,
and they're together. And they're trying to figure out how to work all that out. And there's important things that they have to think about. Okay, this is very common. Over 50% of Americans have at least one step relative. And there's 1,500 blended families being created every day.
Mm.
So there's important things that people have to think about when that happens.
So people, I think, initially think you need to get married to make sure you financially are secure with each other. You talk about insurance and that sort of thing. But
well,
in your opinion, is it better to get married a second time around or not?
That's a great question. It's complicated, okay? Whether to legally get married is a huge decision. Ohio used to recognize common law marriage, but since 1991, they don't.
Mm-hmm.
So when people used to be together, you know, and not bother tying the knot legally, the law used to do that for you, but it no longer does. So you have to decide, do you want to legally get married or not? And there are huge ramifications if you do.
Talk about some of the benefits of, you've got a mom who's got a couple of kids, a dad with a couple of kids, and why they should get married. What are the benefits of that, financially speaking?
The benefits could be fringe benefits at work, like health insurance.
Mm-hmm.
That's a huge one. A lot of people get married or stay married just to be eligible for the spouse's health insurance. That's enormous in today's day and age. So that's one of the biggest ones that I see.
What about the red flags? Why should they not consider it?
Well, I'm not going to say not exactly, but here's an example. Under ERISA law, your 401k at work, your spouse has to be the beneficiary of that. So let's say you get married just before you retire with a big 401k. Your new spouse would have to sign off if you don't want them to be the beneficiary of your 401k. That's not the case with your other financial accounts. That's one example.
You can't make your children the beneficiary of that?
Your spouse
as long
has
as
to
they
sign,
would sign
off.
Off.
Your spouse has to sign off.
Automatically.
On the 401k.
That's a tough dinner question.
Okay.
Hun, can we talk?
Exactly. These are tough,
wow,
tough questions.
Sure.
Okay. Another one is, let's say it doesn't work out the second time around. Two-thirds, unfortunately, don't. Okay. Everything you acquire after you legally get married is marital property. That's divisible. That means the other spouse gets half. So that's another thing to keep in mind. There's also potential spousal support duties. Okay, a lot of jurisdictions award alimony where you're gonna equalize the incomes, and they'll impose that. So that's another thing to think about.
This is why you need to talk to this guy right here, because who knew?
That's,
I mean,
right,
we just talked about this for 2 minutes, and
right,
I had 10,000 more questions.
Right.
If you have financial questions like I do and you need more information, you need to call the good folks over at Szarka Financial Services. You can simply head to our website, foxa.com, and click on Seen on TV for more information. Alex Manassa, thanks so much.
You're welcome.
What a treat.
Great job, as always.
Good information.